the National Hockey League. Hockey at its best. The NHL, where the action is. And this is the story of the 1972 NHL playoffs for the top prize in all of hockey, the Stanley Cup. The Boston Bruins and the New York Rangers. But first, let's take a quick look at how the Rangers and the Bruins made it to the final. In their earlier quarterfinal series, New York Rangers met the defending Stanley Cup champions, the Montreal Canadiens. The Rangers were hampered with injuries to several key players, while the Canadiens were the hottest team in the league when the regular season ended. Thus, everything pointed to a Montreal victory over New York. However, six games later, after some superb performances by Rangers such as Walt Tkachuk and Bill Fairbairn, who were especially successful at stifling the Canadiens' potent power play, and some great goaltending by Eddie Jackman, New York had eliminated the Canadiens. The first time the Rangers had defeated Montreal in Stanley Cup play in 22 years. Next, New York met the Chicago Blackhawks, who had dispensed with the Pittsburgh Penguins in the minimum four games. The experts predicted a six or seven game series between the Rangers and the Hawks, who finished first in the NHL's West Division during the regular schedule. But New York won in a surprising four straight games. Jackman had suffered a knee injury in the first game, but Ranger goaltender Jill Villemure took over and was unbeatable for the final three games of this semifinal series. And now, the Rangers would be making their first appearance in the Stanley Cup Finals in 22 years. In the meantime, the Bruins met the Toronto Maple Leafs in their opening round, and although the series was over in five games, the Maple Leafs, with 69-year-old King Clancy taking over for ailing coach Johnny McClellan, gave the Bruins plenty of problems with the persistent checking style of play. In fact, all but one of the games were cliffhangers. Three of them decided by one goal. And when it was all over, Boston coach Tom Johnson stated he was mighty glad to see the end of Toronto for this season. In their second round, the Bruins faced the St. Louis Blues, who had previously eliminated the Minnesota North Stars in a series which took sudden death overtime in the seventh game to decide a winner. However, the Blues, who made the 1971-72 season a rebuilding year, were overmatched against the explosive, high-scoring Bruins. The Blues were demolished in four games as Boston set a new playoff scoring record with 28 goals. Scoring leader Phil Esposito was up to nine goals when this series ended, and Bobby Orr's 15 assists gave him a new playoff record for defensemen. And so the Bruins reached the Stanley Cup Finals in nine games, one more than the minimum, while the Rangers took 10. And now the stage was set to determine the Stanley Cup champion of 1972. New York scored early in the first game to take a 1-0 lead when defenseman Dale Rolfe fired the puck past Boston goalie Jerry Cheever. The Boston Garden fans were rather anxious as the visiting Rangers threatened to add to their lead. But Cheevers, who during the regular season had an undefeated string of 33 games, made several big saves in the Bruins' goal. Around the five-minute mark, Johnny McKenzie got Boston going, setting up linemate Fred Stanfield for the tying goal. Now it was the Bruins' turn to put the pressure on around the New York goal. Lafleur's sizzling slap shot is deflected wide of the net. But Jackman loses his goal stick as Ken Hodge grabs the rebound. The puck comes back to Don Orie. He shoots. Jackman saves, but Hodge backhands the puck high into the net to make it 2-1 for the Bruins, and the Boston fans go wild. Boston has a man in the penalty box, but New York simply can't beat Cheevers. The Bruins got excellent penalty killing from Eddie Westphal and Derek Sanderson, who incidentally has been hospitalized between games for a stomach condition. That's Westphal, number 18, stealing the puck from the Rangers. Ahead to number 16, Sanderson, and watch this. Sanderson's remarkable shorthanded goal makes it 3-1, and just 45 seconds later, Hodge scored a second shorthanded goal to give Boston a 4-1 lead as the second period gets underway. Cheevers saves on Tkachuk, and the Bruins start back on the attack. Number 7, Phil Esposito, the NHL's leading scorer and all-star center, fires a wrist shot at Jackman. He saves, but Hodge slams the rebound home for his third goal of the game, a hat trick, and Boston takes what appears to be an insurmountable 5-1 lead in this opening game. Right there, many might have expected the Rangers to pack up and return to New York. But in unbelievable fashion, the Rangers charge back. In super slow motion, we see how the Rangers' hard work pays off, and they narrow the margin to 5-2. Cheevers makes the initial save, but number 7, Rod Gilbert, blasts the rebound home. And so manager-coach Emil Francis watches as Rangers go into the third period, still a big 3 goals down. Make that 2 goals down as Vic Hadfield's shot eludes Cheevers at the 1:46 mark, and this game isn't over yet. Tkachuk shoots, and it's 5-4. The Boston fans are stunned by New York's dramatic comeback. The Bruins are in trouble. New York has the momentum and swarm into the Boston end. Number 27, Ted Urban, chases the puck back of the net, gets it to Bruce McGregor, and we've got a tied-up hockey game at 5-5 with just over 10 minutes to play. The Bruins seem dazed. They let a 4-goal lead slip through their fingers. But Mike Walton passes ahead to Garnet Bailey. And that neatly executed goal by Bailey makes him the hero of the first game. Boston wins 6-5 to take a 1-game lead in the quest for the cup. They came out hitting at the start of the second game, and obviously the Rangers were paying particular attention to number 7, the ever-dangerous Phil Esposito. Both clubs changed goaltenders for this game. Ed Johnston took over for the Bruins, Gilles Villemure for the Rangers. And Johnston was called upon to make several spectacular saves in this, the first period. In super slow motion, watch number 4, Bobby Orr, make one of his patented moves to set up Johnny Busick for the first goal of the game. Into the second period, and Esposito gets a great scoring opportunity, but Villemure somehow managed to keep the puck out. Again, Esposito fires, and again, he's robbed by the little Ranger goaltender. Here come the Bruins, but Ranger captain Vic Hadfield, number 11, has other ideas. over to Jim Nielsen. A perfect pass to Rod Gilbert, and the game is tied up at 1-1, and that was the score at the end of the second period. Continued to carry the play to the Bruins in the third period until they ran into penalties, and then the vaunted Boston power play went into action with a two-man advantage. That's Ken Hodge scoring the winning goal. Boston takes a two-game lead in the series, which now shifts to New York for the next two games. New York is now wearing its home ice white sweaters, while Boston is wearing black. Cheevers is back in goal for the Bruins, Jackman for the Rangers. As the game gets underway, the Rangers are on the attack. Bill Fairburn has the puck in the corner. It goes to Hadfield. He gets it to Brad Park, and it's 1-0 for New York on Park's goal. Boston storms back, and Jackman is called upon to make save after save. And Esposito is thwarted again. Referee John Ashley keeps an attentive eye on the action. This was Ashley's 680th career game, and as it turns out, his last. He announced his retirement after 13 years as one of the NHL's most respected officials. Jackman continues to confound the Boston shooters, especially Esposito, who's getting chances but just can't score. And in the meantime, New York made it 2-0 on a goal by Rod Gilbert. The Rangers are playing with more confidence here at Madison Square Garden. The puck comes across to Park, and he fires his second goal of this first period and gives New York a 3-0 lead. But the Bruins aren't giving up. Mike Walton finally figures out how to beat Jackman on this play. Let's watch it again in slow motion. Walton waits for Jackman to commit himself, then shoots to make it 3-1 going into the second period. Now, keep your eye on Boston's number four, Bobby Orr. Orr brings the Bruins back within a goal of the Rangers. But within minutes, Gilbert scored to make it 4-2. Park assisted on that goal, giving him 4 points in this game, 2 goals and 2 assists. Sensing their first victory in the Stanley Cup final, the Rangers continue to attack, and Peter Stemkowski makes it 5-2. Here's another look at Stemkowski's goal. McGregor lays a perfect pass on Stemkowski's stick. And that's the way the game ended, 5-2 for New York. Now Boston leads the series 2-1. Game four, and we get off on a rather exuberant note. We'll be right back. The game was barely 5 minutes old when the incomparable Orr shot the Bruins into the lead. Jackman was kept busy. Watch this stop on Esposito, who by now must be wondering what he has to do to score. But Orr again finds the range. His second goal, and Boston leads 2-0. Let's look again at Orr's goal, this time from another angle. Into the second period, and remembering how the Rangers came back in the first game, Boston isn't letting up. New York keeps trying, but the Bruins goalie, Ed Johnston, is playing exceptionally well. Don Marcotte, number 21 for the Bruins, picks up speed. He drops the puck to Orr. Back to Marcotte, and Marcotte gives Boston a comfortable 3-0 lead. However, the Rangers got that goal back quickly as Stemkowski sets up Ted Urban. Now in the third period, Boston leads 3-1 and threatens to add to its margin. But Jackman is equal to the occasion. Again, Esposito is frustrated by the New York goaltending. How long can the Rangers continue to shut out the man who scored 66 goals during the regular season and 9 more in the 2 preceding playoff series? New York made it 3-2 on a goal by Rod Seeling late in the game, but the Bruins held on to win and take a 3-1 lead in the series as the scene shifts back to the Boston Garden. Those pennants spell out the 4 previous times the Bruins had won the Stanley Cup. A win tonight would make it 5, and the Boston Garden is full of anticipation. Boston wasted no time. In the first period, Wayne Cashman, number 12, slips the puck between Villemure's legs, and the capacity Boston crowd is ecstatic. For the Rangers, they must win to stay alive. Intercepts a Boston pass. Over to Tkachuk. Johnston makes the save, but the rebound comes to Dale Rolfe, and Rolfe makes no mistake. Let's watch that tying goal in slow motion replay. Rolfe sidesteps the defender, then fires the Rangers right back into contention. Fairburn, who's having a great series, just misses, and Boston returns to the attack. Hodge is all alone in front of Villemure, and he makes it 2-1 towards the end of the first period. Veteran Johnny Busick barges in on Villemure in the second period as the Boston power play pours it on with 2 Rangers in the penalty box. But Brad Park gets an unbelievable breakaway. Park's shot caroms off the crossbar, and now in the third period, Boston is only 20 minutes away from the Stanley Cup. However, the Rangers aren't about to concede, and Bobby Russo blasts the shot and ties the game at 2-2. Villemure was virtually unbeatable in this third period, facing 17 Boston shots, and with less than 8 minutes to play in regulation time, Irvin digs the puck out to Russo, who scores the winning goal. Russo's second goal of the night extends the series, and now it's back to Madison Square Garden in New York for Game 6. Cheevers is the choice for the Bruins in goal, and New York goes again with Villemure, who played so well in Game 5. With the Bruins enjoying a manpower advantage, the puck comes back to Orr at the point. He spins away from his check and shoots Boston into the lead, 1-0. That was remarkable Bobby's fourth goal of this series. Without Villemure, the score could easily have been much higher. And in the second period, it was Cheever's turn to shine as the Rangers tried desperately to score. Wayne Cashman scored in the third period to give Boston a 2-0 lead. Time is running out on the Rangers as Esposito sets up Cashman for his second goal of the period to make it 3-0 for the Bruins. The final seconds of play tick up. The Boston Bruins have won the 1972 Stanley Cup Championship, the greatest honor in all of hockey. NHL President Clarence Campbell presents the Stanley Cup to Boston's Johnny Busick. It's the second time in 3 years the Bruins have captured hockey's most coveted prize, and the Ranger fans, although disappointed by the outcome, stood to cheer the champion, the Boston Bruins. Also, for the second time in 3 years, Bobby Orr was voted the Conn Spythe Trophy as the outstanding player of the Stanley Cup playoffs, the first player to win this honor twice. The All-Star defenseman, playing despite a knee injury which required surgery at the conclusion of the playoffs, was obviously the difference between these two clubs. And so the National Hockey League's 55th year of play is history. It was people, excitement, action in the Stanley Cup playoffs. The greatest championship event in all of sports.